but I want to hear him. One of the worst things that happened in the, as a result of the colonial period, is the whole fixation of fixing things into a rigid castes, which wasn't so rigid. And this is done, it's explained here how Lord Risley, he was a racist, very well-known racist. In Europe, after Darwin comes up with the theory of evolution, some people take Darwin's idea and start talking about human races being less evolved and more evolved. Even though Darwin did not want to apply it that way, he was talking about plants and animals and how they evolve and all that. But some people started saying that these Africans are less evolved, Europeans are more evolved and so on. So this evolution of races became known as race science. It was a science taught in European universities called race science. It was considered knowledge, a branch of science. And there you would study races from a scientific point of view to discuss who's better, worse race, you know, all that. And Lord Risley was a race scientist who was appointed to be the census commissioner of India. So his job was to come up with the census of India using the framework of race. Okay. So this framework of race that he Risley did in 1901, like the, every 10 years there was a census. So he started listing the different jatis, and he called them castes. Casta is a Portuguese word, it's not even a Sanskrit word. So he referred to them as castas or castes, and he took all the jatis, made his own judgment on who he thought is more superior and who's inferior, based on who resembled more some Europeans, who was closer to them, or who was better off in terms of economic strata. So he made it. He made his own hierarchy, and in his first census report, when he's writing his comments in the beginning of his census report, he says that some of these people are so ignorant, they don't even know which caste they are. I have to tell them which caste they are. Yeah, because the head of the jati would say, we don't fit in your framework. We can't tell you how many people are here, there. We can't even relate to this. It was a foreign framework forced on them. But gradually, people started complying with this colonial lens of caste framework, because this is how you could get facilities from the government. You had to be included in the government naksha, in their map. You had to be included somewhere. You had to fit somewhere. And then you could get the facilities from government, whatever the government facilities were, because the British were running the government. So, you know, if you wanted any facilities, you can't be an outsider to it. If you were an outsider, those people were called tribes. So even tribe is a kind of a very prejudiced term. We should not use to some jatis, we should not call them tribes. Tribes is also a colonial term for people that they were not able to, quote, civilize. Those they could bring into their framework and put them in a hierarchy of your upper caste, lower caste, this one, that one, that one. Those are called castes. And then the others are called tribes. And they also had this Criminal Tribes Act. Because some of the tribes would fight by what today would be called terrorists. You know? They would fight for their homeland. They would fight for their homeland. They did not want British cutting the forest and building railways and so on. They felt that the British are disrupting their economy, their ecosystem. And so these tribes, so-called tribes, these communities living in forest areas would, sabotage some convoy and all that. And they were considered very terrible people. And so they were called criminal tribes. So the Criminal Tribes Act said that any member of one of these tribes is a criminal by birth. So means a newborn baby, from the moment he's born, he's already a criminal. So they were subject to Holocaust. We don't genocide. We don't talk about these things. Thugs. We've accepted the word thug as a pejorative, but it's a jati. There's nothing pejorative about them. It's like Patel or Malhotra or Kapoor or Smith or whatever. It's just a community. But the British characterized them, branded them as a criminal tribe and among the worst. And so after enough usage, the word thug became we also accept it as, if somebody's a thug, it means that he's a criminal kind of person. But it was just the name of a community. So this whole casteization of India is being blamed. Now the worst thing is that they start blaming the Indians for it. So after creating this, then they're saying this is part of your heritage and you guys are caste or castist and all that. But actually this has been imposed on us. So what would I do? I would remove all privileges based on collective identity, like caste, and I would give privileges based on individual need and individual merit. So if a person is poor, he's poor. He needs help. If a person is physically disabled or in some underprivileged situation, and there has to be a criteria for what constitutes, you know, being underprivileged. So anybody who's underprivileged as an individual needs help. It has nothing to do with his fathers, great fathers, and the rest of the people in his caste, because you can have billionaire Dalits also. And you can have poor Brahmins also. In fact, you do. So it has to be, once you shift this emphasis from caste-based privilege to privilege based on individual need, then you also dismantle the whole caste vote bank kind of structure, because then, you know, rather than giving vote to a political bank who's going to look after your whole caste, that no longer would be the case. So these are very big sweeping changes. If they are ever going to happen, it will take a lot of courage from your people.